Hi guys, I'm going to explain a verse that is confusing to a lot of people, where he talks about not only hearers of the law, but doers of the law shall be justified. Yet we know by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. Please watch the video I just posted about fulfilling the law versus works of the law. Okay? We fulfill the law once we're trusting Christ alone, because he lives in us, and then the heart desires the law. The works of the law are self-effort in the flesh to keep it, but without the rebirth, you can't fulfill the law. You see? That's the difference. They don't understand what we're saying when we say completely don't repent of your sins and all this to be saved, because that's outward stuff you're trying to change. Got to clean the inside of the cup, then the outside will start to become clean. Okay? That's why we must have the real gospel, that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day according to scriptures, 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. If anything's added to that, it's a false gospel. You have to completely trust in what Christ did to justify you or make you righteous. Lawrence, thank you for sending me the commentary on Romans done by Luther. It's amazing. Okay? That man was starting to get the revelation of God's grace near the end of his life. It's absolutely amazing. Okay? Again, please watch that. I'm not telling anybody to break God's law, but I'm telling you, if you keep it in your flesh, even if your heart still desires it, you haven't fulfilled it. You see, you might not commit adultery because you don't want to break his law on the outside, but your heart still desires the adultery. You see, you can't fulfill it until you have the rebirth, and you only have that by complete trust in Christ, realizing that your good works are even trash, that there's nothing good in you, nothing at all. Okay, so none of your behavior change, and offering your disgusting sins as a sacrifice is strange fire. He only accepts the blood of the Lamb as a sacrifice for your sins to be purged. All right, now I'm going to explain this. Now, when God says, not only hearers of the law, but doers of the law are justified. First of all, nobody is justified by doing the law, because nobody's kept it but Christ. So what does he mean here? All right. If he tells us by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified in his sight, then why would he say doers of the law are justified? Because nobody does the law. Okay, see, the Jews, you got to read in context, and I'll read it to you here in Romans 2. The Jews were thinking because God gave them the law and they heard the law that they were justified just because they were Jews. But then Paul goes on to tell them, but the Gentiles, they kept the law and didn't even know the law because it was in their conscience. It was written on their heart. See, we ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and got a conscience to try to discern good and evil. Okay, and we were never supposed to do that. We're supposed to eat from the tree of life, which is Christ. So what he's saying here is, just because you heard the law and you think you keep it, doesn't make you justified, because the Gentiles were keeping it and they never heard it. So see, doers of the law, not hearers only, okay? He's just telling the Jews, you're not justified just because you were given the oracles of the law, okay? That's all it is. It has nothing to do with you keeping the law to be saved, all right? And I'll explain all of that. It's clear by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Now let me read you Romans in context with what I just explained. Now hear it. All right, it says, for as he goes on, first he's telling the Jews, you're inexcusable. You think because you were given the law, that and you judge others because they don't know the law, that and they don't keep the law, but you don't keep it either. You're keeping it inside, okay? You're not keeping it inside. You're keeping it on the outside, and therefore it's just works of law and not fulfillment of the law. Please watch my other video on that. It says, for as many have sinned without the law, that's Gentiles, shall also perish without the law. It means everybody's going to die. And as many have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. That's the Jews. Okay? For not hearers of the law, Jews, are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. Then he goes on to explain, but nobody's done the law except Christ. Okay? So read all of Romans 2 with that context and it'll make sense to you now. Now, the just, justified by faith alone in what Christ did, the gospel, 1 Corinthians 15:1-4, that Christ died for sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day. There's nothing good in you. Your good works are trash because they're not coming from your heart. Even if you avoid that sin on the outside, your heart still desires it and it's not fulfilled. All right, that's why the rebirth is necessary. Now, the just shall live by faith, okay? We are justified to God by faith in Christ. And because he lives in us, he'll help us establish the law because our very hearts will desire it. See, when it says you hate the things God hates, love the things God loved, you don't do that on your own efforts. It is a rebirth. It is a work God does in you. Okay? He creates in you a new heart, a new spirit. He makes you reborn of God, and then you desire these things, and the more you grow in His grace, the more power and desire you have to live a godly life. It will not be a struggle anymore, okay? Now, the flesh wars against the spirit. We know that. And sometimes we'll fail, but our hearts will always be fulfilled. We'll fulfill the law because Christ is in us, you say? It's not the flesh. In my flesh does no good thing, all right? Paul struggled against the flesh constantly. Let me give you some things about how the law, doing the works in your flesh of the law, keeping them in your flesh, can't fulfill it because it's fulfilled from the inside out. All right, Romans. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. All right, they mock it as easy believing, but how can anyone born of God mock God's power unto salvation? How can they mock it and call it an unclean thing and trample His blood underfoot? You see? That's what that means. It doesn't mean you out-sin God. You know, the doctrines of devils will always be vague. How many works? How many sins? Because we can't repent of all of them. Oh, you just got to be willing? Where? Where's that verse? It says it's not for him that willeth or for him that runneth, but of God who showeth mercy. It'll always be vague, and it will always point to you instead of the Christ on the cross. Okay, that's a doctrine of devils, and I'll do a video exposing all of that nonsense. All right, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law. For if I had not known lust, except the law said, thou shalt not covet. See, the law was given to us to show us how we fail, how deep our iniquity goes, to make us all guilty before God, so that we turn to Christ on the cross and rest in what He did alone. Because we can't keep it. No matter how good we think we are in the flesh, that's why Jesus rebuked the Pharisees. They kept it on the outside, but inside were full of all uncleanness, dead man's bones, whitewashed tombs. Okay, I'm trying to explain it. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yay, we established the law. How do we do that? Well, once we trust in Christ, okay, now babes in Christ, they're in a process, and all of us are in a process as we grow in His grace. But the new spirit comes and lives in them once we trust in Christ. And because the one who fulfilled the law now lives in us, we fulfill it. And from the heart out, then the outside starts to become clean, you see? He says clean the inside first and then the outside of the cup, all right? So when we do that, our hearts desire the law. Even if we fail in our flesh sometimes, it's fulfilled in us. And then we'll see progress because it's effortless. We're just going to hear the Spirit and desire what's right, okay? That's why the rebirth is necessary. That's why you can turn from all these sins on the outside and fix the outside, but until you have that rebirth and realize how deep your iniquity goes, you won't get it. I'm going to read you some of this by Luther, okay? For as many are as of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is every one that continues not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. And it says, now we know that things soever the law says to them, that's under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Whosoever shall keep the whole law and offend in one point, he is guilty of all. See, nobody's kept it. That's why he's saying not only the hearers, but doers only. But that's not what he's saying, that nobody can do the law. He's telling the Jews that just because you were the keepers of the law, the hearers of it, doesn't make you any more righteous than the Gentiles who did it just by their own conscience. You're not lifted up or saved because of your genetics, or that God, because God sets you out as a holy people to Himself to keep His oracles. Okay, that's what he's saying. But if you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. See, the Spirit's in you. You don't even have to think about the law because He's going to tell you in your heart what He desires. All right? Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. For by grace ye are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God. All right. So let me read you some stuff here that Luther wrote. It's really amazing. You must not understand the word law here in human fashion, a regulation about which sort of works must be done or not be done. That's the way it's written with human laws. You satisfy the demands of the law with works, whether your heart's in it or not. My last video explains all that. You might not commit that adultery, but you really want it in your heart, and you have not fulfilled it, even though you did the works in your flesh. You see? God judges what's in the depths of the heart. Therefore, his law also makes demands on the depths of the heart and doesn't let the heart rest content in works. We've got to come to the ends of ourselves. Rather, it punishes it as hypocrisy and lies, all works done apart from the depths of the heart. All human beings are called liars, that's Psalms 116, since none of them keeps or can keep God's law from the depths of his heart. That's why repenting of sins can't save you, and you can't add that to the gospel. You got to completely trust in him, and then you get the rebirth, and then you'll start to establish the law from the heart out, okay? It says, everyone finds inside himself an aversion to good and craving for evil. Where there is no free desire for good, there the heart has not set itself on God's law. There also sin is surely to be found, a deserved wrath of God, whether a lot of good works and an honorable life appear outwardly or not. I've been trying to explain this to you. You can clean up this all day long and stop all these behaviors and drop right into hell. Until you've trusted on Christ alone, come to the end of yourself, your mouth may be stopped, that nothing you do can be offered to God. You must receive what he's offered you, the blood of the Lamb, the blood of his precious Son, to justify you alone, okay? Therefore, in chapter 2, St. Paul adds that Jews are all sinners and say that only the doers of the law are justified in the sight of God. What he's saying is that no one is a doer of the law by works. On the contrary, he says to them, you teach that one should not commit adultery, and you commit it. You judge another in a certain matter and condemn yourselves in that same matter because you do the very same thing you judge in another in your heart. Do you understand that? It is as if we're saying outwardly, you live quite properly in the works of the law and judge those who do not live the same way. You know how to teach everybody. You seek the speck in another's eye, but don't notice the beam in your own. See? They judge by the flesh. God judges by the heart. Outwardly, you keep the law. You act out of aversion and force. You'd rather act otherwise if the law didn't exist. See, that's the difference. You got to have that rebirth that makes you want to love the things of God. And you can't love them by making yourself, oh, I love God's law. I love what he loves and hates what he hates. No, that's hypocrisy. You must truly have a rebirth, a new heart, a new spirit that God puts in you when Christ is in you. Okay? You won't want this stuff. That's why I tell you, don't repent of your sins in your flesh and struggle against the flesh. No, you get the rebirth, trusting in him, living freedom and joy and no bondage, because that's bondage. Trying to keep this law all the time. Oh, did I sin too much? Did I turn from enough sins? How many good works? And doctrines of devils, of vagueness. And it's all pointing to you and not to Christ on the cross. That's crazy. You'd rather act otherwise if the law didn't exist. It follows then that you, in the depths of your heart, are the enemy of the law. What do you mean, therefore, do you teach another not to steal when you, in the depths of your heart, are a thief and would be one outwardly too if you dared? Of course, outward works doesn't last long with such hypocrites. That's why you'll see these pastors getting all this trouble. So then you teach others, but not yourself. You don't even know what you're teaching. You never understood the law rightly. From an internal perspective, you didn't understand the depths of your own depravity. Furthermore, the law increases sin. Again, strength of sin is the law. That is because a person becomes more and more an enemy of the law, the more it demands of him that he can't possibly do. That's why Jesus upped the standard. You look at a woman with lust, you committed adultery. All right? Chapter 7, St. Paul says, the law is spiritual. What does that mean? If the law were physical, then it could be satisfied by works. That's why I'm telling you, you can change all this outward behavior and you haven't filled anything. You're a worker of iniquity. But since it's spiritual, no one can satisfy it unless he does, springs from the depths of his heart. But no one can give such a heart except the Spirit of God. There you go. There's your rebirth. Who makes the person be like the law so that he actually conceives a heartfelt longing for the law and henceforward does everything not through fear or coercion, but from a free heart. Such a law is spiritual since it can only be loved and fulfilled by such a heart and such a spirit. If the spirit is not in the heart, then there remains sin, no matter how much outward behavior change you make, people. Now, how can a work please God if it proceeds from a heart that still desires that thing? And don't say, oh, I don't desire it anymore. Well, if you don't, then you probably have the rebirth. But you need to really ask yourself, have you ever trusted completely in what Christ did, knowing that none of your works, none of your turning from sins and all that garbage can save you? It's complete trust in what he did to get that new spirit so that you start wanting the things of God, because Christ in you desires them. Do you understand? So if you're keeping the laws in your flesh, but your heart still wants it, you still want it, but you're just going to keep yourself in check here, garbage. It's of you, all right? But to fulfill the law means to do its work eagerly, lovingly, and freely, without the constraint of the law. It means to live well in a manner pleasing to God as though it were no law or punishment. That's why I keep saying it's not some struggle, oh, I got to do the right thing, I'm going to go to hell. No. You know you're saved, secure in joy, freedom. He saves you to the uttermost. The good work he began in you is going to finish. They hate us for having this security because we're not perfect in our flesh yet. They want to see the perfection in our flesh. Garbage, okay? It's not an effort anymore. You know, you just wake up every day and let the Spirit guide you. And when it comes up, you just, no, I don't really want that. It is the Holy Spirit, however, who puts such eagerness of unconstrained love into our heart, as Paul says in chapter 5, but the Spirit is given only in, with, and through faith in Christ alone, what he did, people. Not none of you should be in the gospel. It should be about nothing you're doing. The only thing it should be about you is receiving the gift, free gift of eternal life, by faith. Okay, it's not what you're doing at all. This is the work of God, that you believe on he whom he sent. That's the only work you do. You trust Christ, in whom we also trusted, and after that we received the Holy Spirit of promise. All right? That's why. Doesn't matter if you're doing it out here, if you still have an unwilling heart and a desire for the things like that. All right? Now, I'm not talking about people that have addictions and their flesh is sick and desires the drug. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about an iniquity that comes deep within the heart. All right, because you don't murder that person, but God, you hate him, and you want something bad to happen to him. It doesn't matter that you didn't murder him, because you murdered him in your heart. You didn't keep the law. You didn't fulfill it. You did the works of the law by not killing him, but you killed him. You didn't fulfill it. Sin in the scriptures mean not only external works of the body, but all those movements within us which bestir themselves and move us to do the external works, namely the depths of the heart with all its powers. Therefore, the word do should refer to a person completely falling into sin. No external work of sin happens. After all, unless a person commit herself to it completely, body and soul, in particular the scriptures see, into the heart, to the root and main source of all sin, unbelief in the depths of the heart. Thus, even as faith alone makes just and brings the spirit desire to do good external works, so is it only unbelief which sins and exalts the flesh and brings desire to do those external works, although it be evil. They are workers of iniquity. It's not coming from the pure Christ in them, but their own trying to be righteous in their flesh. That is why only unbelief is called sin by Christ. See, he died for the sins of the whole world. The world is judged for its sin because it would not believe on me, is what he said. That's the sin that drops you into hell. No faith, not putting all your trust in what Christ did. Okay? There it says, the Spirit will punish the world because of sin, because it does not believe in me. I just said that. Furthermore, before good or bad works can happen, which are the good or bad fruits of the heart, there has to be present in the heart either faith or unbelief, the root, sap, and chief power of all sin. That is why in the scriptures, unbelief is called the head of the serpent and the ancient dragon, with which the offspring of the woman, Christ, must crush, as it was promised of Adam. Grace and gift differ in that grace actually denotes God's kindness or favor, which he has done toward us, and by which he is disposed to pour Christ and the Spirit with his gifts into us, as becomes clear from chapter 5, where Paul says grace and gift are in Christ. The gifts and the Spirit increase daily in us. And again, the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. He'll never take them from you. You can't lose it, okay? I just wanted to remind you of that. And the gifts and the Spirit will increase daily. That's growing in his grace, people. You'll see progressive change. Okay, it's not some woke up the next day, I decided to get myself clean, so the outside is clean, you don't have the rebirth because you put part of your works into the gospel, that accursed gospel. They added keeping the law or turning from sins to his finished work. You don't add what's complete. You understand? You take it. You look upon Christ on the cross with complete faith and trust, just as they looked at the bronze serpent Moses lifted up. They looked upon it with faith and were saved. We look upon Christ on the cross with faith and are saved. That is the rebirth. It is that simple. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Faith is not that human illusion and dream that some people think it is. When they hear and talk a lot about faith, yet see no moral improvement, no good works result from it, they fall into error and say, faith is not enough. You must do works if you want to get to heaven. The result is that when they hear the gospel, they stumble and make for themselves with their own powers a concept in your heart which says, I believe. This concept they hold to be true faith. But since it's human fabrication and thought and not an experience of the heart, accomplishes nothing. And there follows no real improvement. Okay? You must trust in the finished work of Christ with all your heart. That is it. Now, it's not the measure of your faith, but the object of your faith. We don't have faith in our faith. It's Him. Every bit of faith we have, we put on. The faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It is to be persuaded and convinced that something is true. So they don't really believe the gospel. See, they don't believe what Jesus achieved. Oh, it's not enough. That's easy believism. But it's not your believing that saves you. It's what He did that saves you, and you receive it by believing. Okay? Faith is a living, unshakable confidence in God's grace. It is so certain that someone would die 1,000 times for it. This kind of trust in and knowledge of God's grace makes a person joyful, confident, and happy with regard to God and all creatures. Okay, what are these people missing? They have no joy, no security. Then they hate you and come on these channels and say, no, but you can lose this. You can take yourself out of His hands. And what about this verse? And your faith without works is dead. And the demons believe because they don't understand Scripture. And they twist it all up and they hate your security because the Spirit isn't in them. And then they mock God's power unto salvation as easy believism or cheap grace, which isn't cheap at all, but completely free. It's God's generosity they're mocking. It's Christ on the cross they mock, okay? So let them go ahead and do it, because they can look good to the world and sound right, but there's a way that seems right to man. The end thereof are the ways of death. This must happen inside out, people. This has to happen first. The real gospel, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved, period. They omit hundreds of verses on faith alone and then find one or two that seem to say something different, like hearers of the law, not hearers, but doers only. See, you got to do the law to keep it. They don't get it. Okay? The point here is nobody does the law and can't be justified by it. He said if the law could bring life, then Christ wouldn't have had to die. You see? But it can't. It's perfect, holy, and just, but we're not, and it can't make us that way. All it can do is give us a mirror in front of us to show us how we fail keeping it. All right, we must come to the depths of our own depravity. There's nothing good in us. So all this behavior change is garbage. Don't offer strange fire unto the Lord trying to offer your sins to Him. Only the blood of the Lamb will He receive. Cain tried to offer his works. He went away unjustified. And then Abel offered the blood of the Lamb. But what did he do to that? The one that was under God's grace? He killed him. Because he hated it. He hated God's grace. And they do the same things. They murder you with hatred and accusation. But stand firm in the grace of God. We have joy. We're not in bondage. They want to put you back in bondage. But those that tell you to keep the law, they themselves don't keep it. Those that tell you got to submit your life. How much do you have to submit? All of it? How come you still got that expensive house? You didn't submit that. They teach lies and hypocrisy. Okay, it's all what Christ did. And then you can fulfill the law because He's in you. Get the inside clean first, people. All right, God bless.